I am James O'Barr, artist, writer of The Crow, and comic books aren't just things for movie companies to exploit.
Sequentially, yours, cinematically ours. I'm Karu, and this is Debbie.
Hello.
Hey there. All right, so everybody's talking about it, and it does, in fact, have comic books associated with it, so we're going to discuss Ghostbusters. We'll try to talk about it non-spoilery at first. We'll let you know when the spoilers happen. You know how this works. So let's get started. What'd you think?
I really liked it. I people can savage me online, whatever, I don't care. I really enjoyed it. I'm going to say a heretical thing. I enjoyed it as much as the first one.
And there we go. I am going to point out that we were paid $60 quintillion by Sony for a positive review.
Yep.
This is just up front so that you know that we have been paid ludicrous amounts of money and for some reason are still doing internet videos as opposed to traveling or, you know, anything else other than making internet videos.
We're waiting on the check to clear. That's all.
There we go. Yeah. I thought it was good. I don't think it's as good as the first one. I think the first one was sort of lightning in a bottle. That's never going to happen. But I will say that it's probably better than Ghostbusters 2. And I love Ghostbusters 2. Ghostbusters 2 is the one I saw in theaters because I was too young to see the first one. I was 2 years old when that came out. But I saw Ghostbusters 2 in the theaters. That's the one I feel nostalgic about, but even I can admit that that was not a very good movie, and this one, honestly, was better. In general, I think that it spends a lot of time referencing the original, and it's at its best when it's not doing that. When it's doing its own thing is when it actually really sort of pops and does, you know, something interesting and clever. Those were the parts that I liked the most, was when it wasn't referencing the first one. You know, if anything, I think maybe it needed to be less beholden to the original and more just its own movie that also happened to be a Ghostbusters film.
I would counter that a little bit. I tend to agree, but I would counter that a little bit with the fact that this movie could not win no matter what, because if they hadn't had as many nods to the original, then you would have had people screaming on the internet about how, oh, this isn't really a Ghostbusters movie, blah, 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 blah.
While that is true, and I will grant you that, I would also argue that there is no pleasing that crowd of people, so you might as well have made a better film. And this is still a good film, but they might as well have made a better film that didn't have to nod as frequently and as often to the first one, since you're not going to please the people who the nods are for anyway. It's just not going to happen.
Fair. And, oh, we should mention, while I'm thinking about it, I did not grow up with Ghostbusters as a kid. I only watched Ghostbusters, the first one, 6, maybe 8 years ago, and I had only watched the second one the night before we saw the movie. We saw the movie last night, and we watched both movies the night before. So, yeah Wednesday night. So, yeah. I don't have nostalgia goggles for this one.
I, on the other hand, flat out, I will admit that I grew up with the Ghostbusters. I had the toys. I loved my proton pack, and especially my trap. It came with the proton pack basically came with a little, like, felt ghost, and it had a Velcro thing on the end, so when you push the button, the Velcro bit goes out, and you can capture the ghost.
Nice.
So I had that, and I also had the trap, and I figured out a way to take that felt ghost and place it on the trap just right so that when I pressed the button on the trap and it opened up, that it would fall into the trap.
Nice.
That's one of the things. But, like I said, though, the first one was not really my thing. I watched the real Ghostbusters like crazy. I loved the real Ghostbusters. And I've watched through about season 3. I decided to rewatch it just to see what it's like. And it still holds up pretty well in a lot of cases, and I think that's because J. Michael Straczynski was the story editor on it, and almost guaranteed the episodes he wrote were always the best of them. But still, it did a lot to kind of build on the mythology for it. Speaking of mythology building, I've also read all of the comics, and, you know, this is a comic show, so I want to talk about the comics for a second.
Absolutely, yeah.
The comics are amazing. Now, I have said this before in other contexts, and I will say it again, I am such a world-building geek. To know how everything works. I want to know all of the ins and the outs. I am not the kind of person who's like, oh, well, it was better when I had no idea what was going on. No, I want to know what's happening. Just an example, I thought it was incredibly cool that, you know, Dan Aykroyd really believes a lot of this stuff. So when he put together the first one, one of the things when they're talking about proton packs, it's because he believes that ghosts are essentially negatively charged ions that exist in our world, but they are for the most part just, you know, mostly electron, not as many neutrons to the atom. So basically what the proton pack does is they are positively charged ions that are being thrown out, and the reason why they swing it around like that is because they're essentially fishing, and the magnetic pull of the negative ghost and the positive proton pack beam sticks together, and that's what they're doing when they're wrangling it in. But it's basically fishing is what's happening there. So I love that stuff. So reading the comics, that is a lot of world building. I mean, just tons and tons of world building. It actually takes the characters that we know and expands on them. It expands on the team a lot. Kylie from the Extreme Ghostbusters, which a lot of people, you know, don't really like. I think it's because they don't like... I'm not sure if any of them have seen it. It's actually a pretty good show. But Kylie made the jump over from Extreme Ghostbusters to the comics. She's Ray's assistant. She's really good at research. She runs the bookstore when he's not around. There's an FBI agent that also becomes a Ghostbuster for a while. Janine picks it up. Oh, excuse me. Rookie from the game is a Ghostbuster. They introduce new things. Walter Peck comes back. Peck is so well characterized in the comics. I cannot begin to describe how much I love the way they do Walter Peck, because he's still a jerk. He is still a jerk, but now he's the Ghostbusters jerk. And he does really kind of jerky things, but, you know, but he's doing it because he wants the Ghostbusters to succeed. He doesn't like them, but it's his job to make sure that that the investment that the city is placing in these people is worthwhile. So it's really an interesting way of characterizing this character. It's like a very complex character for being Walter Peck. You know, another thing that I like is that Winston's going to night school. He's becoming a lawyer, so you get to see him using those sort of skills that he's building in order to help the team out. He has a girlfriend who becomes a fiancé and eventually a wife. Read the comics. Trust me, read these comics. These are worth your time. Even if you don't see this movie, and now to bring it back, see this movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, you talk for a little while. I've been taking all the air up here.
It's really good. Like I said, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it as much as I did the first one. I like all of the four main women. They were all great. I had a hard time picking a favorite, but they all felt like real people. They all felt like women I've known, friends I've had. Especially Kristen Wiig and Melissa McCarthy's characters, Erin and Abby, respectively. They feel like two women who have been friends since childhood and had a falling out and still haven't worked through it. And they feel very real. And I said this about when we watched both the first two movies the night before. I said I was impressed with something movies do well very rarely is portray real adults.
Yeah.
And all three movies, these are very realistic adults with adult responsibilities.
Even Ray, who is kind of a big kid, is still a grown-up.
Yeah.
You know, he's a grown-up who gets really excited about things. He is a nerd the way that you and I and you and all of us are nerds, that we have our things that excite us, and when we get excited about it, it's hard to kind of bring us back, but that doesn't make us any less of grown-ups. Pokemon people that are trying to shame us. Yeah, all of those anti-Pokemon Go posts, I'm talking to you people, you are the problem. You are not more grown-up than us, you are the problem. Anyway, sorry, go on.
What I was going to say is, in watching the second one, because like I said, I hadn't seen it before, I noticed that when Dana has Louis, or well, gets Janine to watch the baby, and Louis comes along, no hijinks happen with the baby.
Yeah, Louis isn't sitting there running around the apartment like, oh no, where did he go? Is he under the bed? Oh,
yeah.
Oh, Janine had him the whole time. No, that didn't happen, no.
Yeah, so many movies and shows portray people with children, like, as if, you know, changing diapers is the height of comedy.
Yeah.
Or apparently, horror, depending.
So have somebody change a diaper in a movie and suddenly they become the person who doesn't know how to use something in an infomercial.
Yeah. Yeah, it's...
It's not that difficult, people.
Bizarre. These are things that millions of people do every day. This is not that hard. And, yeah, there was no hijinks. They watched the baby. The baby did get abducted, of course, but...
It wasn't played for comedy, it was played for horror.
Yeah, it was played for horror, and it didn't happen until after Dana got home.
Yeah.
So it was in no way, there was no glimmer of ever blaming the babysitters for this.
Yeah. They were busy making out while the baby was asleep. Oh well, they're grown-ups. It happens.
Yeah, yeah.
And we get that same sense from the new movie, that these are grown-ups that have their own lives.
Yeah.
And... when they're doing grown-up things, that is not an excuse to make it into a joke like they are incompetent.
Yeah, yeah, that's one thing. All of the characters in these movies, except with the possible exception of the villain in the new one, behaved mostly like real adults with real responsibilities.
Yeah.
Which I really liked that. And, yeah, I identified a lot with these characters, Aaron and Abby, and their friendship, Patty, who's the actress's name I cannot remember.
Leslie Jones.
Thank you. Leslie Jones, I was very nervous. Oh!
Yeah, oh, so nervous about Patty.
We should comment on the trailers. I thought the trailers were okay.
Yeah, I laughed at parts of the trailers. They were fine. Half the trailer disappeared anyway in the final cut. We'll get to that later.
Yeah.
But yeah, a lot of the scenes in the trailer just did not appear. They used different takes in the actual movie. I don't know whether that was a response to people's response to the trailer, which it was admittedly bad. It was really kind of put together horribly. But yeah, a lot of it just absolutely disappeared.
That's true. But what I was going to say was, in the way they portrayed Leslie Jones' character, Patty, in the trailers, I was very, very afraid she was going to be turned into the stereotype of screaming black woman.
Yep.
Madea! Madea!
We have terrible coughs.
Oh, clearly.
Terrible, cynical coughs.
Yeah.
Yeah, and no, she wasn't. She's actually played back really well. I adored Patty. Patty and Holtzman were the ones that really stood out for me as probably my two favorite characters. And depending on my mood, I can't tell you which one was my favorite, but I adored both of them. And the thing that I liked about Patty is that she is the research person. that's her thing. It's not that, mm-hmm. you know, it's, yes, she's not a scientist in the same way that Abby and Aaron are. She's not an engineer like Holtzman. Her specialty is basically that, as far as I can tell, she has a photographic memory.
Seems to.
Yeah. Yeah. She has a photographic memory, and she knows a lot about, she knows a lot about a lot of different things. She reads a lot, and therefore has sort of a general knowledge to draw on.
Mainly New York history.
Yeah, mainly New York history. She is, for all intents and purposes, the Ghostbusters historian. And yeah. this ends up playing into the plot, and we'll discuss that after the spoiler card.
Yeah.
But, she is basically the Ghostbusters historian, and it plays into the plot a lot, and it works.
Yeah.
It works really well. It's, you know, again, it's one of those where they're not trying to do what the original Ghostbusters did, where they're not trying to specifically reference it. It works well, and this is one of those places that, other than the comics, there really isn't a researched Ghostbuster that's, you know, Ray and Egon's thing. They research stuff when they are not busy running experiments or having sex with slime. I just want to remind you that that happened in a movie, a Ghostbusters movie, where one of the characters admits to having sex with slime.
Yeah.
And it's not this one. It's one of the other ones.
I like both of those movies, but please remember, people, they are not perfect.
No, they are not. All right.
The first one does have flaws. It really does. It's a good movie. It's a very, very good movie. But it has flaws.
Yeah. All right, so is there anything else we want to cover in the kind of spoiler-free section, or do we want to just throw a spoiler card in?
I did want to mention on Holtzman, I liked her character a lot. I thought she was very funny. And I think Kate McKinnon's a great actress.
Oh, yeah.
She did a phenomenal job. I did feel a bit like she was being, and this felt more like it was coming from the from Paul Feig. Excuse me.
Is it Feig or Feig?
I'm not sure. I've heard both, so.
We're going to pronounce it both ways.
Yeah.
And Mr. Feig, whichever one it is, we apologize for the other
one. Yeah, yeah. I'm sorry.
It's a standard here at Sequentially Yours to get people's names wrong and to pronounce them wrong. It's part of our charm, and we apologize, that you will ever watch this film, this video.
But I felt like, and I've liked movies of his before, just for the record. We adored Spy.
Spy is so good.
I really like The Heat. Have you seen
The Heat? I have not seen The Heat, no. I saw Bridesmaids, but I did not see The Heat.
The Heat is a lot of fun.
Absolutely.
It's a lot of fun.
We'll watch that and Hot Fuzz together and have fun with that.
There you go. I like this
idea. We have fun here.
Yeah, we do. And Bridesmaids, as he mentioned, and I quite liked Bridesmaids. It was very funny.
Bridesmaids took me by surprise, and I really enjoyed it. And I liked Melissa McCarthy going back to Gilmore Girls, but I was still iffy on Bridesmaids, and I liked it.
Yeah, so, but I felt like the director was pushing Kate McKinnon, pushing her to be overly quirky. And she's a fairly quirky character, which is fine. And very funny, but in some scenes I was like, can you kind of rein it back in just a bit? Can you dial it back from 11 to about 8?
That seems reasonable.
It was a little much sometimes.
There are times when she seems to inhabit a more cartoony world than the rest of the characters do.
Yeah.
As much as I adore this character, I will admit that there are times when it's like, how do you live in the world that everyone else does when you do things that really shouldn't work?
Yeah.
And which, again, we'll discuss.
Yeah.
Post-spoiler.
Yeah.
So, should we... anything else?
That's good. We can go to...
If you're avoiding spoilers, then let's just say, yes, this is a good movie. Watch this movie.
Yeah.
It's worth watching this movie.
Yeah. If you can get out and see it this weekend...
Do so.
Yeah.
It's worth it. All right, so...
Oh, we should mention one other thing real quick. We did see it in 3D.
Yes, we did see it in 3D. We did not see it in IMAX 3D.
Yeah.
We saw it in standard 3D. they use the 3D very well, actually.
Yes.
There's a little bit of 80s 3D where they pop stuff out of the screen, but not too much, and it doesn't overstay its welcome.
Yeah.
More than anything, the 3D is used to not only give depth to what's going on, but also to sort of overshoot the letterboxing.
Yeah, there were some, in the end credits, there were some ghostly vapors above the letterboxing, which was, I thought was really cool.
Yeah, it looked good.
Yeah, yeah. And it, in general, it's a very good-looking movie. It's a really gorgeous movie.
Yes, oh, absolutely.
Incredibly colorful. So, yeah, go see it.
All right, so now we're going to put in the spoiler card.
Spoilers.
I was wondering if you were gonna do that.
Always.
Alright, so spoiler section. Alright, so let me start by saying that my favorite part of the movie is actually the end. There's a fight sequence at the end. And this fight sequence is amazing. Essentially, the girls are... I don't know if it was actually... I keep saying it's Times Square, but I don't think it actually is. I could be wrong. We visited New York over Christmas, and I kind of got a thing for New York geography. I think it's really fascinating.
All our navigating.
Yeah. So I'm pretty sure that it was in Times Square because it looked kind of like it, but it didn't really look entirely like it. And
yeah, I can't be sure either.
It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
The point is that they had this fight sequence. They're in the middle of the street. Ghosts are all over the place. And this is their opportunity to break out some of the weaponry that they had sort of set up earlier in the film. And one of the things that I really like about this film is that there are more kind of gadgets and gizmos.
Lots of new weapons.
And I think that this part of this is because, unlike the original Ghostbusters, they have an engineer. The original Ghostbusters engineers were Ray and Egon, who were also their researchers and their research scientists.
Yeah.
So they spent a lot of their time doing research science. And really, the only time we got something new out of them was in number two. We got the slime guns, which were cool, but only because they sort of spent the movie setting it up. In this case, you have somebody who is dedicated to doing nothing more than coming up with cool new ways to take out ghosts.
Yeah.
And this actually reminds me a lot, again, of the comics, where you get to see a lot of new ghost-busting equipment, and a lot of it's really cool, really clever, and... that's really what we got here, is just really clever, visually interesting things. And they get to show it off in this one fight sequence, which is very quick and very, you know, basically there are ghosts coming out of the fog at them. And one thing that they do in this one is that not all the ghosts are trapped. You know, they are manifested energy. You can bust them up. You can use your, the proton packs can pick them up, you can slam them into each other, and they'll disintegrate. It's a thing that happens, and I think that's fine. It made for a really quick fight sequence. And, of course, the best part is, you know, in the trailer we see Holtzman pull out the two guns and lick one of them. The part right after that was so good.
Yeah.
Just absolutely badass. Yeah. I loved... she's sitting there ripping ghosts apart with these things. It was great. Right. Yeah. I loved watching this.
Yeah, it was the choreography and the timing on that scene, that whole scene, were perfect.
Yeah.
Spot on. Absolutely spot on.
And again, it's one of those trailer was a misrepresentation. The scene where it shows Erin doing a John Woo style flip. No, she rolls on the ground in the movie.
Yeah.
That I don't know why they bothered to get a stunt person in for that. That seemed like... that was one of those... I can almost imagine that day was Paul Feig going, you know, let's try this out. Let's see how it looks. And then looking at the dailies and being, oh, wow. And then it got sent to the trailer people. But no. And again, this brings up the fact that the original movie didn't really have any action sequences. Most of the action was them standing still and... pointing at things.
Yeah.
This was a lot more energetic and frenetic, and I loved seeing that sort of energy being put into this. All the movement that was happening. It wasn't, like you said, it was the choreography on it was good. It wasn't over the top.
Yeah.
But it definitely felt like these things are a threat, not these things will wait until I take the time to take off the gun thing and point at it and hold on for a second.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And commenting, too, on the CGI. CGI looks great.
Yeah. I like the CGI on this, too.
The ghosts, I love the neon. The ghosts look very neon and very... A little Day of the Dead, perhaps?
A little bit, yeah.
A little Dia de los Muertos.
Yeah, that Day of the Dead, not the Romero film.
Yeah, apologies to any Spanish speakers. But, yeah, they were really visually interesting to look at.
Yeah, and yeah, in some cases they are a bit cartoony, but yeah. I was okay with that because it made them seem otherworldly. It made them seem like they're not really a part of this dimension. They come from someplace else.
Yeah.
That's not to say that all of the effects were perfect by any stretch. They were.
No,
but,
no.
The opening scene is probably the most frightening Ghostbusters scene ever filmed.
Probably,
That was, for a Ghostbusters movie, terrifying. It was really well done.
Yeah.
It is creepy as all get out.
Yeah.
I was very happy with that. Mm-hmm. I was very happy with that ghost. I bought into her.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's a... Yeah. It was a really kind of perfect opening scene for the movie, for sure. And the atmosphere was extremely well done, and it was pretty restrained. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't over the top, and there's a lot you don't see, and there's a lot they play with, sound in that scene.
Yeah, the sound design was very well done on this film.
Yeah, oh, absolutely, yes. So, yeah, the opening scene was great. It was really awesome.
Yeah. I liked that. One of the only thing that there's a couple of things that I would have preferred that they did when it comes to how they told the story. One of the things that you find out along the way is that Erin was haunted for a year when she was a young girl. Basically, the mean old lady next door died, and every night Erin would wake up and her ghost would be sitting at the standing at the end of her bed watching her.
Said she was 8.
Yeah, I did? Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. So she was 8 years old. So basically from 8 to 9, every night this ghost would just be there when she woke up in the middle of the night, which would be terrifying, and she told everybody and nobody believed her except for Abby.
I would be terrified of that as an adult.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if I woke up and there was a ghost at the... Yeah, absolutely. I don't believe in ghosts, but... That would be a terrifying thing if suddenly I had evidence of them and it was right there.
Definite evidence in front of you. Yeah, you would believe in ghosts.
Yeah, exactly. So, I would have liked to see that rather than we're told about it in, you know, kind of flash, not even flashback. We don't see it. Erin just describes it. And I would have liked to actually see that.
I would comment about that scene. The good thing is the way it's completely played straight. It's not in any way played for laughs, which I liked. It was a very genuine moment.
Yeah, more movies, I think, need to have those types of moments where they sit back and relax. It allowed us as viewers to process what was going on. We got new information about the characters.
Yeah.
We got to see... And it was not a wasted scene. It was not all... Let's develop Erin. We got to see how everybody else reacted to her, and therefore we got more information about all of these other characters, which worked out well. The other part of that that I think I would have liked to kind of see a little bit differently was... I'm forgetting it now. It's related to the original bit and all of that, but... Oh, yeah, Erin and Abby's kind of falling out. I believe that they had a falling out. I just would have liked to see what that falling out really was. It seemed like they just sort of drifted apart. And I think something more along the lines of, I would have liked to see Erin turning her back on all of this to pursue her own career in academia. Basically, one of those, she left Abby because she wanted to be a tenured professor, and she knew that as a ghost hunter, that was never going to happen. That's what I would have liked to see. Instead, it seems like they just, you know, Aaron just stopped believing somewhere along the way, and Abby kept the flame alive. And
yeah, it. They had written a book together, and you know, a fairly sizable book, 400 pages.
Some pages, yeah. They say the actual name, the number of pages in there.
And and now she's not. And talking plot. Hey, Sammy.
Hi, Sammy.
Talking plot.
She's purposely avoiding the camera right now.
She does. We keep telling her we'll make her internet famous.
She's a diva. She's not going to do it unless she has the right amount of money.
Clearly.
Anyway, sorry. Please go on.
So if you want to make Sammy famous, support our Patreon.
Yes. Which you can do right here.
Anyway, what was I saying? The cat distracted me.
Yeah.
That happens.
The cat in blatant salesmanship.
Yeah. But
The book.
Thank you.
The book. Yeah. Aha.
Yeah. They had written a book together, and yes, apparently, Aaron wanted to pursue academia and be taken seriously. And at the beginning of the movie, she's working at Columbia University.
Yeah, she is. She's going to get tenure like any day now.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, she's been very successful.
Yeah, that is tough. Columbia is a top-tier school.
Yeah.
And to be teaching particle physics at Columbia, to be a tenured professor at it, that is amazing.
Yeah, and someone comes by with the book and says...
Ed Begley Jr., actually.
Yeah.
I saw him, I'm like, Ed Begley... shouldn't you be, like, powering this film with a bicycle or something? He does that with his house. Like, he wakes up in the morning and...
Really?
Yeah, and he gets part of his power from his house by bicycling. Like, a stationary bike. I'm not kidding. He is, like, super environmentalist. That's his thing.
I did not know that. That's really cool. Good for you, sir. Awesome.
Yeah. Now you know.
Yeah, very cool. So, yeah, he shows up with the book... looking to find her, and she's like, how did you find this book? We burned all 2 copies, I think she said.
Yeah.
And turns out, Abby had put it on Amazon. So, Aaron goes to find Abby to get her taken down, and she says she will if they will go and check out, go meet Ed Begley Jr.'s character, whose name I don't remember.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I think his name was actually Ed something.
Yeah, I think it was.
One of the jokes in there that I really kind of liked, I wouldn't say it was one of the best, but one of the jokes I really liked is they go there and they talk, he's the owner of the house that was haunted the first scene. And they go and they talk to the kid who was terrorized in the first scene, who won't even cross the street to go in front of the house.
He was a tour guide.
Yeah. And they show up and they're like, well, we were talking to Ed whatever. He came to my place of work and he wanted to have us look at this. And the guy's like, Ed whatever has been dead for 15 years.
Yeah.
And then Ed Begley Jr. shows up. Him! Oh, that's Ed Jr., his son. He owns the place now. It was a funny joke.
It was a nice little bit of absurd humor.
Yeah.
Because you're like, wait, what? Okay. Because I had it in my head, I'm like, did we just see a ghost? Was he a ghost?
No, it was just a pretty well put together joke.
Yeah, it was like, all right, this is a good start. Of course, pretty much right after that, they kind of negated it. With a shit joke.
It's one of those, they added, there's a lot more slapstick and kind of kid-oriented humor in here, and it doesn't quite work as well.
In some places. This one would have been better if they kept carrying it a little too long.
Yeah. Like two jokes riffing on this particular subject, three at the most, would have been fine. But they kept it going and kept it going. And it's just one of the it's part of the evidence of the really uneven editing that went into this film.
Yeah.
The editing on this really baffles me, because there are places, especially in the third act, where it's very clear that they edited this movie with a meat cleaver. And part of that is that Paul Feig's writing is very, very tight. So you can see where clearly something was supposed to be. There's a sequence where the main bad guy is essentially all of the cops and
army
people and whatnot that are outside of the building where he is. He partially possesses them and he makes them do this.
Yeah.
Which it looked like they were getting set up for a dance sequence, Beetlejuice style. But then nothing happens with it, and they're just sitting there pointing at the sky. And when you see the credits, they film the dance number, and they finish the dance number, and they put it basically over the credits and use the stuff that's happening on screen to interact with the credits that are rolling. So when, you know, Chris Hemsworth swings his hips to the side, he'll knock some of the credits off over a little bit and stuff like that. But
which was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun to watch, but it was clearly cut out of the film.
Yeah.
And instead, you just ended up with this really weird thing that happened.
Yeah.
I'd like to see a director's cut to see what else was cut out, because there's a lot of other times that it feels like something's missing here. I want to know what that thing is, because what we're seeing just doesn't make quite enough sense.
Yeah. I do want to comment while I'm thinking of it. I didn't realize Chris Hemsworth was such a good dancer.
Oh, yeah. Of course he is.
Fair.
He looks good. He is... he's incredibly kind. He's an excellent actor and a great dancer. Of course he is.
Yeah. Very charismatic.
Smart guy.
Yeah.
He and Ryan Gosling are basically perfect people.
Yeah, kind of.
I don't know if Chris Hemsworth has stopped a mugging, but I wouldn't be surprised if he tried.
Yeah, I believe it. I believe it. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
No, go on.
I was going to say, it's a perfect segue into talking about his character.
Kevin.
I got to give the guy credit. I already thought he was a pretty good actor. But Thor does not give him... Thor does not have a huge amount of range.
No, Thor's Thor. It's,
Thor's a fairly basic character.
Yeah, Thor is at his best when he is playing off of somebody else, either Loki or the Avengers, because they give him somebody to be.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the whole point of Thor is to be the best person possible.
Yeah.
That is what makes Thor, is that he does the right thing and he's kind and generous. That's what makes him worthy of Mjolnir. So you don't really get to see Chris Hemsworth doing much more than being just a really great guy.
Yeah.
Which
is... And I thought he was good doing that, but I hadn't gotten a lot of examples. And I don't know if I've seen many other movies that he's been in. I can't think of any off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But I hadn't really seen much example of his range. And here, his character is amazing.
Oh, Kevin is hilarious.
He is dumb as a post.
Yeah. Oh, so dumb. But it's not one of those... He's dumb because he's a man and therefore can't do standard things.
No.
He's dumb because he's not that bright.
He's dumb because he's dumb.
Yeah, some people just are. And it really gave, according to Kristen Wiig, it actually gave him an opportunity to improvise a lot of the lines. And you can tell some of the things that he improvised that I just lost it because it was so funny.
Yeah.
And even some of the stuff that was obviously written because they would have had to.
Right.
It was also incredibly funny. Some of it was a little strange, but even then, I'm okay with a strange joke here and there. I grew up on Monty Python. One of my favorites being at one point the phone's ringing and ringing is just sitting there, not doing anything. So at one point the girl's like, Kevin, could you answer the phone? Oh, it's in the... oh, it's in the aquarium. And he points to the aquarium, and there is, in fact, a phone sitting in the aquarium. I'm like, no, the one on your desk. Oh! Why is there a phone in the aquarium? I don't know, but I'm okay with a little bit of absurdity in my humor.
Yeah.
And it worked really well, the fact that there actually was one there.
Yeah. Yeah, the moment that got me the most, and he had a lot of good moments.
Oh, yeah.
But the thing that got me the most is the point at which you realize how dumb this guy is he goes to rub his eyes. He's wearing glasses. He goes to rub his eyes and proceeds to stick his fingers
through the frames.
And you're like, wait, what?
And then the characters realized it.
And then the characters realized it about the same time you as the audience were realizing it. And they looked at each other and they said, you know, what's up with your glasses or something, words to that effect. And he's like, oh, they kept getting dirty, so I took the lenses out. And I was just a little bit dumbstruck. I laughed, but I was like, oh, this guy is really that dumb?
Yeah.
Really, really that dumb?
And he plays it so straight.
Yeah.
And that's what makes it funny, is that he just plays it straight. You don't... later on, they tell him to walk away so they can talk amongst themselves about hiring him. Like, all right, don't listen. And he's like, oh, don't, I won't. And he's covering his eyes.
Yeah, like this. Like this. He covers his eyes so he doesn't listen.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a thing. And it was great.
And wasn't there a point at which they said, don't look, and he covered his ears?
I don't remember that, but it's possible.
I thought I remembered that, but I might not be remembering that right, but it was very funny. He was great.
Yeah. All right, and going over to other to funny, Holtzman. One thing I liked about her is that she was also hilarious at times, and mostly she was hilarious by being very snarky, and she had a lot of the meta commentary on the film, where in many ways she was responding as the audience would respond, just in an overabundant way.
Yeah.
I can't remember what they said. They said something, or was like, what? And Kate McKinnon is such a standout in this.
Yeah.
I really loved her character. The only thing that I mentioned earlier is that sometimes it feels like she is inhabiting a slightly more cartoony universe than everybody else.
Yeah.
There's a scene where she is dancing with two blowtorches. And she lights something on fire, and the fire just sort of flames in this one area until she can dance over with a fire extinguisher.
Yeah. Yeah, it was... that. I will grant, though, that particular scene was really, really entertaining.
Oh, it was incredibly entertaining. It's just one of those... Yeah, Holtzman is just kind of a... She lives in a slightly cartoonier world than everybody else.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
See, I liked seeing her hit on Aaron. The character is gay, but the studio would not allow them to make it explicit, but I don't know how much more explicit you get when she is blatantly hitting on Aaron.
You have them say it on screen. That's how you get more explicit.
Yeah. No, it's one of the first things she does to Aaron is, do you come around here often? The winking from the trailer, that's at Kristen Wiig's character.
Yeah.
And you know what? It is fantastic. Mm-hmm. I buy into it. It adds to the humor. It is really kind of great development for this character. I love watching this person on screen.
Yeah. Yeah. She was great. Aside from what I said earlier, I thought she needed to dial it back just a little bit. But yeah, she's really good. Very funny.
Yeah.
And very much inhabiting the whole mad scientist thing.
Yeah.
But in a fairly realistic way. Like, she loves what she's doing. Clearly. Yeah.
Not all of the cameos from the original cast worked, but one of my favorites was Sigourney Weaver at the end of the film. She shows up for a minute or two as Holtzman's mentor and is just as crazy. Watching these two amazingly talented women play off each other, even if for 2 minutes, is such a delight.
Yeah, I loved that scene. that was great. She was really entertaining, and which is cool because Sigourney Weaver doesn't get to play quirky and funny very often.
No, she was the straight man in both of the Ghostbusters films. She was the one who was supposed to be terrorized because she's normal. And, you know, yeah. Her other really famous part is Stone Cold Badass Ellen Ripley.
Yeah.
Who also does not get to be quirky. She gets to be very serious all of the time.
Well, she's in a terrifying situation.
Oh, yeah, she is. No, and I think that was appropriately written character.
Oh, absolutely. Her. Absolutely.
But, yeah, people forget that Sigourney Weaver started out as a comedian. And she started out in comedy. So getting a chance to see her do comedy is not... Even her character in Avatar was kind of bland. So seeing her do comedy like this was actually really... It was a delight. It was a pleasure. Yeah. It was really great.
Which I guess that would make sense to go into... If you were done.
No, go ahead.
Into the other cameos.
Yeah.
The Bill Murray cameo is probably the only one... Neither of us really liked at all.
He had the longest cameo. It was not very clever. It was just, hey, guess what? He's playing a skeptic now. I feel like this was Bill Murray. He wanted to write his own parts. Otherwise, he wasn't going to do it. And they said, okay, fine.
Yeah.
Because you know what that cameo comes off as?
What?
That comes off as a Wes Anderson character in a Ghostbusters movie.
Yes. Actually, yes.
Yeah. I just realized it as I'm saying that. I'm like, that's basically a Wes Anderson character, which is what Murray likes to do right now. He likes to do...
Yeah, he's been doing that for several years
now. He either wants to do dramas or he wants to do Wes Anderson comedies. So that's basically what this character was. He was a different sort of quirky. He was the Wes Anderson sort of quirky where the quirks come from the fact that he deadpans everything or is very quiet about everything. And they murder him off.
Yeah.
They murder him.
He got thrown out the window by a ghost.
Yeah. He doesn't believe in ghosts, and then he got thrown out of the window by one. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Let's see here. The Dan Aykroyd one, I'm not sure how to feel about that one, because I don't think it knows what it wants to do with it.
Yeah, it was a little confused.
He's a cabbie. Aaron tries to get a ride to Chinatown where their headquarters is. They're above a Chinese food restaurant. And first he calls her crazy for believing in ghosts. And then he refers to the things outside as level 5 free-roaming vapors. Either you think she's nuts and you don't want her in the cab, or you're referencing the fact that you played Ray Stans. You gotta pick one. You can't do both.
Yeah, and he ends, like, the last thing he says before he drives off is, I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
Which was part of a longer sentence.
Yeah.
But...
Yeah.
It worked enough. It wasn't great. It wasn't terrible.
Yeah.
The Annie Potts one was phenomenal.
Yeah.
It was nice to see her. It was nice to see her curse.
Yeah.
She got, like, the one curse word of the movie.
And it fit probably, I felt like it was the least shoehorned in cameo of all of them, really, except possibly Slimer.
Yeah.
Because she's playing a clerk at a hotel, at the hotel, the main hotel in the story.
Yeah, the Cameron?
Mercado.
Mercado, that's Mercado. What it was, yes.
And
the Market
Hotel. And it was here, and it was quick, and boom, 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 and she said, I don't even remember the line, but she said a lot, something she had said in one of the first movie, I think.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
There was a reference in there.
Yeah.
Ernie Hudson's cameo was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because they you don't realize that they have been setting it up the entire movie.
Yeah. Because Patty says...
Yeah, Patty keeps talking about her uncle who owns a funeral home, and that's where they get the hearse from. That is the Ghostbusters ghost-busting Ecto-1.
Right.
It's Ecto-1. And it turns out at the end that Ernie Hudson is, in fact, the uncle that she keeps referencing, which was a nice touch. I liked it.
It was.
The firehouse makes an appearance.
Yes.
But it's not kind of the main setting like it is in the other movies.
Which was really, I thought it was so well handled, because that's one thing that wasn't realistic about the first movie, that they would have been able to, even though, yeah, technically I guess he mortgaged his parents' house to pay for them starting the business, right? That is.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but you're not going to be able to afford that building in Midtown Manhattan on that money.
In Tribeca. I mean, seriously. Yeah. That's not... No, it's not going to... Yeah, a house in the suburbs is not going to be able to mortgage you enough to buy something in Midtown.
No.
Not a whole building.
No.
Not going to happen.
No. And in this one, yeah, they go to the firehouse with the real estate agents, like they did in the first movie.
Yeah. And they get excited about it like they did in the first movie.
Yeah. And Holtzman and Abby, am I... Yeah, Abby. Holtzman and Abby are all like, oh, we should do this, whatever. And so Aaron looks at the real estate agent, and, you know, and they're talking about, you know, the amenities and whatnot. Amenities. And she's like, and rent is $21,000 a month.
And just Kristen Wiig's reaction, I'm not going to try to replicate it, because I don't remember it that,
yeah.
But I remember the type of reaction and the timing on the comedic timing on it was perfect.
Yeah. It was a perfect spit take.
Yeah.
It was great. Yeah, I don't remember the line either.
Spit take. I didn't even... Yeah, that's, you're right.
It
is a spit take.
It was a perfect spit take. And it was like... And boom. And they end up at Abby's Chinese restaurant.
Yeah, that also has been a running joke throughout the film up until this point. And it's the same Chinese restaurant that she keeps ordering from.
Yeah.
So, yeah, one of the things that I want to talk about Patty for a second, just because I liked her so much. One of the things that I liked about Patty is that she did serve that Winston everyman role without being, I don't know anything about this, I'm just here for a paycheck, that Winston was. One of my favorite things that she did was they're sort of backstage. You know the concert from the thing?
From the trailers?
Yeah, they're backstage at first kind of looking for this ghost. And you see this room that's just full of mannequins and kind of dim. And you're looking at it like, oh, something creepy's going to happen. And she looks in there and her response is, room full of nightmares. I'm going.
Yeah. And she turns around and walks away.
Yeah, which, great. I love that. That was,
yeah.
And, of course, there was, in fact, a nightmare creature in there. One of the mannequins comes to life and starts following her.
Yeah.
And tries to stop in place when she turns around. Was that there before? Uh-uh. And then she starts running, and it starts to... And it's frightening. It's scary. It really worked out well.
Yeah, that mannequin was extremely well done. It's very...
It was one of the better effects of the film, I think, is that mannequin.
Yeah. It was very... for any Whovians out there watching, it was very reminiscent of the first
Autons.
Episode of New Who.
The Autons.
The Autons, yes.
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 Which was also, they were introduced in the first episode for the Third Doctor as well.
Yeah, fair enough.
That's where the Autons came from, was the first episode for the Third Doctor, and they were a repeating villain.
Fair enough.
I may have watched a lot of Classic Who as a kid. but yeah, it worked, no, it, and, you know, that whole bit worked out well. Like I said, I love that Patty was so well played, and Leslie Jones did such a wonderful job with this character.
A lot of very restrained and very reined in moments with her.
Yeah, it that was the best part about it, was that she got to be smart and a fully fleshed out character and a contributing member of the Ghostbusters.
Not a stereotype in any way.
Yeah, it was so wonderful to see, and you know, she has a range of reactions and emotions.
Yeah.
When Aaron's telling her ghost girl story, how she kind of got into ghosts to begin with, it's Patty that's the one who draws it out of her and is the one who's really listening to her. It works so well.
Yeah. Yeah. The most sympathetic character.
Yeah, easily the most sympathetic of the characters was Patty.
Yeah.
She just really worked. Let's talk about Rowan for a second, our villain.
Yeah.
And we sort of had this discussion last night, but we're going to have it again here, because we're still trying to tease it out. I was not very impressed with Rowan. He seemed a little bland for me. He was threatening, but that's because he sort of had threatening powers. Not because he was a threatening person. It's, you know, it's little Anthony from that Twilight Zone episode that Billy Mummy was playing, where he is basically just a little kid, but he's a little kid with the ability to put people in the cornfield. So, you know, that's kind of what makes him threatening, even though he is basically a little kid. In this case, Rowan has studied ghosts enough that he has control over a lot of ghosts.
Partially from reading their book.
Yeah, partially from reading Abby and Aaron's book. But just because he has this control, and just because he has, that's the only thing that makes him threatening, but it doesn't make him intriguing, it doesn't make him compelling.
Well,
he's a little boring.
Fair. I will counter this a little bit. Pretty clearly very crazy.
Yes, he is very crazy. And the thing that I keep, that keeps bothering me is that, all right, fine, he's crazy, but what made him crazy? As far as we can tell, he was crazy because he was bullied. And they wanted to do a sort of message, not a message, but they wanted to show a dichotomy between Rowan, who was bullied and became, let's be honest, a supervillain, yeah, and Aaron, who was bullied, who became a superhero in this particular dichotomy here. And, you know, it talks about, in a way, the movie is trying to bring up that the choices that we make about what happens to us determines who we are as people. And I liked that about it, but I think we need a little bit more. What made Rowan become a villain and Aaron become a hero? Why the difference there?
Well, you get one side of that, because Aaron comments that nobody believed her except Abby.
Yeah, Abby made her a hero because Abby believed her.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's no indication that Rowan was disbelieved. He was just bullied.
Well, I counter that a little bit with, he's pretty thinly drawn, I agree, Rowan, that is.
Yeah.
I think what they were trying to do is that he is just crazy. I mean, some people are just mentally ill, and certainly exacerbated by bullying. But I don't know, he felt to me very much like just the embodiment of an internet troll.
In many ways, yeah. But even then, internet trolls seek out people to make miserable, whereas he basically was only concerned with talking to the dead. He tried to avoid people as much as possible.
Yes, but he wanted to make people miserable.
Yeah, I suppose he did.
I mean, that was... I will say one thing. I do like... Yeah, he's pretty thinly drawn, and his plan is pretty complicated, and admittedly.
Yeah.
I do like the fact that he isn't really going for let's take over the world, which was, let's face it, That was definitely Viggo the Carpathian's plan.
Yes.
And it was kind of Gozer's plan, too.
As much as we could say that Gozer had a plan.
Yeah.
I think Viggo, I said this last night, I'll say it again, is that I think that Viggo is probably the only Ghostbusters villain who has a, not counting the real Ghostbusters, just within the movies, and I'll even throw the game in here, too, has a plan and is active in encouraging that plan through a method that makes sense. He found a henchman. He had something simple that he wanted to do. Put me in the body of a baby, and then I'll use my warlock powers to do what I want for the rest of my life, which will probably be forever. Gozer doesn't really have a plan because Gozer is a force of nature. Gozer just sort of shows up sometimes. Ivo Shandor from the game and his cult, again, it goes back to the Gozer thing where it's really just force of nature, we're just taking up this thing. Rowan definitely has a plan, but his plan is really convoluted and I don't understand how it works.
Yeah, I agree. That was...
I like the concepts behind it. Mm-hmm. Basically, the idea is that there are two major ley lines that cross each other in New York. And he is using machines to reduce the barrier between the ghost dimension and our dimension and bring ghosts through in order to strengthen the ley lines. I think he was just trying to strengthen the ley lines. I think the ghost coming through was just a side effect of that. Ultimately, it was to get the ghost through, but I don't think, like, for example, Gwendolyn or the prisoner guy, I don't think he cares whether or not they got out. I think that he was just trying to strengthen the ley lines in those areas.
I don't know if I agree with that, because I tend to think that his plan, he wasn't trying to get those specific ghosts out. I don't think. It's just they happened to be conveniently located in the areas he needed. But I think it was eventually to let ghosts out and wreak havoc on the world.
Oh, yes, it was to let all the ghosts out, but I don't think it was those specific ghosts.
Oh, okay, well, yeah.
It just happened to be that when he reduces the barrier on the ley line to get the ghost energy or whatever it is to power these ley lines, ghosts would slip out as a result. He wasn't, you know, purposely trying to summon them, because otherwise that would make even less sense.
I think... Yes, I agree with you, but I to counter that a little bit, I think it worked because it seems to be that they're saying that in this universe, there's a lot of paranormal, a lot of buildings and a lot of history tied in with the paranormal in New York, and I think...
Yeah. Which is where Patty comes in a lot, also. Yeah. Is that, you know, she knows when something is... A building is historically haunted because she's read about it because, again, probably photographic memory plus she reads a lot about New York history.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it, in a way, at least, like, Gwendolyn, the ghost from the beginning, I think he was picking those spots strategically. That seemed pretty clear.
They were strategic because they were on the ley lines.
Fair, but why? I mean,
I think the idea is that the ley lines are already sort of thin, the barrier's already sort of thin there, and that's why there is already those ghost stories, and then he thinned the barrier even more.
Well, yes, but I guess I don't know. This is my speculation. The movie does not explain this particularly well, I admit.
No, it doesn't.
But what they do when they figure this out is they take a map and they start plotting all the various sites, because they had looked on the internet to see all the people that had cited things and what was being talked about. And they marked down all of these various locations. And it was basically, if I'm remembering right, it was point, 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 and then an intersecting point. The Mercado Hotel was an intersecting point.
There were a couple more points in there. I don't remember what the order was that they did.
But yeah. Not to say the order matters, but my point is the fact of it was ordered enough that he was strategically picking points that were roughly equidistant from each other.
Okay, yeah, I can see that.
So I think he was choosing paranormally significant sites.
Fair. I'm just saying that I don't think it mattered to him whether a ghost showed up there. His idea was to get the ghosts out of the mirrors in his place. He wanted to make the Mercado the portal. I don't think he cared whether Gwendolyn showed up. I think he just needed to strengthen the ley line.
Well, I think, yes, but I think ghosts showing up does strengthen the ley lines, though.
I think it was a side... You see, and this is the problem. The movie does not explain this and doesn't give us a whole sense of it. His plan is just really complex, and it's complex to the point that we don't know what is going on here, as opposed to, again, Viggo the Carpathian, whose plan was, bring me a baby so I can put my soul into the body, and then I'll warlock the hell out of this place. I will warlock this up. Done. So, yeah, I think Viggo is probably our best one. Rowan was, again, threatening, but I don't think that his plan made a lot of sense, even in the context of the film.
Which, fair enough. We've kind of been going back and forth on this last day.
At one point, he kills himself to turn himself into a ghost. That was a thing that he did. And that was clearly part of his plan, because they later find a drawing of him doing the exact same thing in his copy of Erin and Abby's book. Like, he drew all over the pages, and at one point, I guess their book stopped having words printed on it, because those disappeared.
Who knows?
No. It was not well put together. It was a poorly put together prop.
Fair.
Is really what it boils down to.
Fair. I hadn't honestly even noticed that until he just said that just now.
Yeah. But it was just really complex and convoluted, and it boiled down to, I'm going to open a portal for ghosts to come through.
Yeah.
And turn New York into the 1970s? I don't get that either. I don't understand why New York transferred to the 1970s.
Yeah, he did seem to be making a point of it being angry, malevolent spirits.
Yeah.
It was wreak havoc on the world.
Yeah.
Was basically his end result.
Right. I don't understand what that has to do with the 1970s, though.
Well, no.
I think this is another scene where that was somehow left on the cutting room floor, the explanation for why that, of all things. There's a certain thing, again, going back to the climax, there's certain thing. Oh, no, first I want to talk about Rowan's, laboratory. Looked really cool.
Yeah.
That looked really cool.
Yeah.
The colors were well used, the production design was clever. The ghost behind the mirrors was interesting.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You know what? If you were to put that in a haunted house, like at the Halloween Horror Nights or something like that, I think that would be really cool and really...
Quite creepy looking. It really was.
Yeah. You could put scare actors behind mirrors and have them doing that, and I think it would be really nifty.
Or you could even have digital randomized ones of, you know, suddenly like a ghost push ups against the mirror and goes away.
Yeah.
I mean there's all kinds of things you could do with that.
Yeah, yeah. The people at Universal or Busch Gardens and Hollow Scream or, you know, whatever, even Disney Imagineers could find some really clever ways to make that happen. But it was a cool visual, and I'd like to see it used more often.
Yeah.
I think they would do a great job with it.
Yeah,
so the whole design, I think, was great. All the production design was really well done. It all looked good. It all looked like it could belong in this world. Again, the stuff that was original worked really well. The way the trap was designed, I thought, was kind of cool. And the fact that all of their gear is sort of able to stick on their backpacks in one way or another, it's all kind of hooked up together. That was nifty and clever and well put and well just designed in general.
Yeah.
And apparently they actually spoke with engineers and people at MIT and whatnot. They made sure that all of the... all of the random, like, equations that you see all make sense.
Oh.
They made sure that all of Holtzman's blabbering about how she improved the proton packs would make sense within this context. You know, assume that one or two things about physics aren't real, and this makes sense. So it was they put a lot of work into making this world fit with itself.
Yeah.
And I liked that about this.
Yeah, and this feels like, aside from, yes, this is about ghosts, don't exist in this world, but the science-y parts of it and the way they talked felt very realistic. And, like, you buy them all as scientists very, very much.
Mm-hmm.
And it's... They went a little heavy on the
technobabble. Yeah, there were a couple of times when they said something and all I heard was, we're going to tech this and it'll be done. And I'm like, okay, you tech it. Go ahead, you do that.
Yeah. I wonder, and this is pure speculation on my part. I wonder if this was a little bit. As much, not that it was there, but as much as was there, was a response to all the internet trolls and the, it's broads. And it was like, these are women who do science. We have to make it, you know.
Very clear.
Yes, that they know what they're doing and they're competent Very as possible. Scientists. And I suspect...
It's just overcompensated.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tara, was there anything else that we really wanted to discuss about this?
Let's see. In general, the very ending, what are your thoughts on the very ending?
I liked the whole, I liked where Aaron goes through the portal to the kind of ghost dimension to get Abby, save her. That worked out really well.
Mm-hmm.
The pseudo Stay Puft Marshmallow Man that Rowan became was, It wasn't necessary because nothing happened with it. A lot of, it's one of those, I feel that there was a lot edited out of this because there's this kind of, there's a giant thing walking through the city that doesn't do anything.
It's just, the logo, by the way.
Yeah, the thing that looked like the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man is Rowan turning into the logo from just giant from the Ghostbusters. Yeah. And wandering through this, but they don't do anything with it. At the end, Abby and Aaron's hair turns white because they go into the ghost dimension and come back out. And they make a big deal out of this. But then they just dye their hair and it's gone. And what happened? Why did that happen? I want to see the director's cut on this. I want to see the stuff that I'm missing because there are so many things that I just don't understand why they put that in there or why it exists. I don't know. What did you think about the very end there?
I agree. The them going into the portal, Aaron going in to get Abby, it was nicely emotionally resonant, and it brought things full circle, because it was basically Aaron redeeming their friendship.
Yeah. It was her quite literally embracing the supernatural in order to come closer to her friend.
Yeah, yeah, which worked really well, and the way it was played, I bought it. Something I meant to say, I really like that in this movie, Melissa McCarthy is...
Restrained.
Largely, very restrained and largely the straight man.
Yeah.
Yes,
we understand.
Yeah.
It's a terminal. It's a term of art. Yeah. She is largely the straight man. It's her job to set up a lot of the jokes.
Which, and I like Melissa McCarthy. Don't get me wrong. I very much like her. She's a very good actress. And she can be a very funny comedian. As we said, we really liked Spy. I liked The Heat a lot.
We like Bridesmaids, yeah.
Yeah, and we like Bridesmaids.
And again, I'm a Gilmore Girls addict. I've loved Gilmore Girls since I started watching in season 3.
Yeah.
So.
And a number of the roles that she's been cast in the last couple of years just seem to play up her as, oh, she's a fat lady and she can't do anything.
There were no fat jokes in this.
Not a single one.
I loved seeing that. It was...
Yeah.
There are times... This is not to say that the movie always avoided low-hanging fruit. No, it didn't. No, there were times when I was like, did you really have to make... That joke was dumb. Did you really have to make that the obvious way to go? But for the most part, when it makes an effort, it makes a real effort, and it hits. Again, I almost feel like it's at its best and it's at its funniest when it's doing its own original things.
I agree.
When it tries to be Ghostbusters 84... or at times Ghostbusters 2, that's when it starts to get boring. And that's when it doesn't work. But when it does its own thing, it's hilarious. And Melissa McCarthy is a great example of this. When she is kind of allowed to set up other people's stuff, and she's not referencing the other Ghostbusters movies, she's great.
Yeah.
And that's really what this is all... That's really kind of the best things about it.
Yeah, yeah. She and her banter with Aaron was some of my favorite stuff in the movie.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
There's a scene where they do riffing on various Patrick Swayze movies, which I've heard some people say it went on too long. I disagree with that. It felt very much like two longtime friends doing a bit with each other.
Yeah. What really worked for me, what really worked for me in these is that I will say my sense of humor, I like dry banter back and forth stuff. Hi, Sammy. I like that dry banter back and forth stuff, so it really worked for me, and I'm okay with it being a little long and them, you know, discussing a bunch of just talking Patrick Swayze movies back and forth and just naming them. That was funny to me. It's not going to be funny to everybody, but I thought it was good. I thought it was hilarious. If you like kind of bantery type stuff, especially dry banter, then yeah, you're probably going to like most of the lines in this.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Oh, and I don't know how much we've got too much more to say. I did want to mention there is a sequel. There is sequel bait at the very end.
Yeah, and it's fine. It's you know, post-credit sequence. It works out well. Yeah, and I really hope that they get a sequel, and I hope that when they that if they well, they'll almost certainly get a sequel, but
yeah,
I really hope that any sequel to this, they're less afraid to step away from the original.
Yeah,
that they take a few more chances. That they take a few more steps forward,
yeah.
Like they did with several of the ghost designs, like they did with the weapon designs, like they did with... one of the things that I liked about it was that part of the joke of the first one is that they are essentially exterminators. They are starting a business, and it's an extermination, blue-collar type business, even though they keep reminding us that they're scientists. Yeah. But they're basically, you know, blue-collar workers, and that's the idea. This one, they maintain their science background.
Yeah.
We're now in a Ghostbusters world where you can disintegrate ghosts with your various weapons, including the punching thing.
You can punch a ghost.
Yeah, you can punch a ghost.
So cool.
Yeah, it was really awesome. I loved seeing that. Yeah, you had that world now, and it just... So they have a containment unit. They're working on a containment unit, but containment is not their primary thing. They don't have to contain all of the ghosts.
They are forever. Aiming to study them. They need containment, basically, to be able to study them.
Yeah. But, you know, for the most part, they can just disintegrate them and send them packing.
Yeah.
The soundtrack, I thought, was good. The score was well put together. There's nothing that really stood out about it, like Saving the Day from the original stood out, but everything sort of supported the supported the action, and I was okay with that. You know, it's not a score that stands out. It's a score that very quietly helps enhance the film. And, you know, that there's plenty of room for a score like that. I enjoyed listening to it. They don't really use the Fall Out Boy Missy Elliott version much. I think they used it possibly once.
Yeah.
I haven't heard it, really. I'm pretty sure that that was it. I like Fall Out Boy. I like Missy Elliott's. I don't know whether I'll like this song or not. I haven't really heard it. If it's the one that I heard in there and it is... It felt more like a novelty song riffing on the Ghostbusters theme than a theme itself. But, you know, the Ghostbusters theme is in there.
Some rather interesting remixes, I thought.
Yeah, there was a good remix that was a little bit more punchy that you hear in the that you hear in the trailers, and I like that remix a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to hear a kind of version that was a little bit more active, and I think that was more active than the original, which is sort of laid back. It's, you know, walking down the street and pointing, if you've seen the music video, you know, just or the opening of the cartoon. Actually, they do that too. Yeah, so the soundtrack I thought was good as well.
He picks up on music much more than I do.
Yeah, I'm a musician, so I listen for those things.
Yeah, so it's not usually I don't tend to notice a ton of things about music unless it's something that really stands out to me. Like I absolutely loved Wonder Woman's song from Batman v Superman.
Yeah, that hit you in the face, that's all.
Yeah,
which was supposed to, because yeah. Wonder Woman's appearance is supposed to hit you in the face.
Yeah, which, that was great. One of the only good things about that movie, you can watch our video, and go here, watch that video. But, point being, I don't tend to know this music, so it was fine, as far as I go. I enjoyed bits and pieces here and there. Good soundtrack.
Yeah. So, I think we can get some final thoughts on this at this point.
Yeah.
So, do you want to go first or shall I?
Go for it.
All right. So, ultimately, it is not a great film, but it is an enjoyable film. Yeah. I liked watching it. I want to see it again. I'll probably wait for it to hit DVD. I don't know if I'd want to go back to the theaters for it. Next major movie is going to be Star Trek Beyond, which we're not covering here, because even though there are comics, that's even a little bit too tenuous for my... Yeah. We've got other things to do for Sequentially Yours and for Cinematically Ours specifically. But we are going to see Star Trek, and that's where my money's going to go, is to see that next week. That being said, though, if you haven't seen Ghostbusters yet, it's worth the price of a ticket. It's worth the price of a ticket in 3D. It's not a fantastic movie. It's not the greatest movie you've ever seen.
No.
It is a solid summer blockbuster. When it does its own thing, it is really good.
Yeah.
And it is really funny. And I really just hope that, again, if it has a sequel, that it has the courage to stop trying to be Ghostbusters 84 and just allows itself to be itself. Because if it's when it's itself is when it's at its best.
Yeah.
Alright.
I really enjoyed it a lot. It's a lot of fun. Some very, very funny stuff. Four very, very funny women playing off each other really, really well. I would say any issues the movie had, none of the actresses are in any way at fault.
Yeah.
All four of them, they play off each other really well. Any issues it has is probably more the writing and maybe the directing.
The editing.
And the editing, yes, thank you. Yes, absolutely.
It's all technical stuff. It's backstage stuff. Nothing on screen was a problem.
I had a really good time. And probably, obviously, if you think you're gonna hate it, don't go see it. You're gonna hate it. But if you think you'll at least have a good time, you'll have a good time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, go see it, support it. We need more movies with awesome female leads.
Yeah, I really hope to see, that's the thing, it's that this is not Fury Road. Don't expect it to be Fury Road, but...
Yeah.
If you want more Fury Roads, then you can't, then go supporting this Ghostbusters movie will help you get to more Fury Roads.
Yeah, yeah. Which, if you haven't seen Mad Max Fury Road, why?
Yeah, that, come on. Catch up. Go.
Amazing. Yeah. That is an amazing movie. Anyway, we're not reviewing Fury Road, so.
So, yeah, Ghostbusters, worth the watch.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Well, that's our thoughts on this. Busting makes us feel good, and we will catch you later. Bye.